us worship God who has done great things. Let us worship God who has caused streams of mercy to flow in the wasteland.
Earth will shout out from God. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Let us worship God in spirit and in truth.
God's people have been singing hallelujah throughout the ages and today all around the globe. And today we join our voices with theirs and we confess our faith in Father, Son, and Holy Spirit with the words of the Apostles' Creed. Let us say together, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. God's good news for you today, his promises of his grace, his mercy, and his peace are for you, the promises that come from God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please take a few moments while you're standing to introduce yourself to someone nearby and to welcome one another to worship. Morning. Krista, I'm not seeing that beautiful smile up there. Give the folks a smile. Okay?
I will.
All right. Please be seated. This morning, our worship time will conclude with the celebration of the Lord's Supper, and therefore we're turning right to God's Word this morning. We're returning to the Essential Jesus Challenge that we have been following 10 weeks in the fall and now 10 weeks in the winter, and we're getting near the end, thinking about the most influential person who has ever lived on the planet, and his name is Jesus. Last week we thought about the suffering of Jesus on the cross, and this morning we're going to think about the resurrected Jesus appearing to his disciples. And if you haven't joined in, or if you want to start a new study, we still have a handful of Essential Jesus guidebooks available and planners. We had a lot of Dort College students here this morning who are on a tour with the band. An orchestra, and if they didn't take them all, there's still some in the entryway in the Family Life Center, but I told them they could take them, so they might be all gone. I didn't check, but it's never too late to jump in. The five passages that we are focusing on this week are on the back of your bulletin, so you can follow along with your triad, your small group at the family dinner table. We encourage you to read about the greatest event that's ever happened in the history of the world, the resurrection of Jesus. As we begin this morning, we're going to be thinking about this word, revelation. Revelation. And before we turn to the scripture passage before us, let me tell you about something that we value very highly in our home. In our home, we value dinner time very highly. And therefore, we are very flexible with when we eat dinner in order to have as many people at the table as possible. And so when we have everybody at the table, you know, that's really a bonus, and sometimes we'll even have something special because everybody's at the table and we have a long period of time, you know, that's a gift. But usually it's, you know, get as many to the table at the same time as possible because something might be happening, you know, after dinner. Now, while that is a value to us and our family, as a dad, I experience a problem often right around that time. Here's how it goes, and you can let me know if it's the same in your house. Everything's ready. We've prepared. Parents have prepared. Kids have helped. But now it's time to eat, and nobody's at the table. So you send out the word, it's time to eat. And this is the response that I often get. I'm coming. And I look at you on the ground, and I think, you're not coming. You're still lying still. I'm coming is not true. And so we have a little debate about that. Or just a minute. Or could it be 2 minutes? And there's all kinds of reasons why not to come to the table when Dad says, come to the table. And so, well, like you, you probably never get frustrated with that sort of thing. But I might resort to a threat. you know, you may not have your iPad for the rest of your life if you do not come to the table. And they know that's veiled, so then I bargain down for a week or a day or whatever, you know. So try to use force to get the kids to come to the table. Sometimes I try to, you know, entice them lightheartedly, sing-songy, you know, and I'll tell them, come to the table if you are able, if your name is not Mabel. You know, I'll try to get them to laugh, and you know, maybe that'll get them to do what I'm desiring for them to do. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. It helps usually if the meal is of a nature of uniqueness that we don't usually have, like, oh, it's this today, or, you know, we ordered pizza from Vitali's or someplace, you know, it's here, it's hot, it's ready, you know, come now. And sometimes you get a little quicker response. But when we have a guest in the house, most of the kids are pretty responsive to a guest. When you have a guest, you know, then everybody's going to sit down at the same time. A guest usually helps. But if there was a guest who was serving a meal, and for some reason you thought this particular meal might change your life, I think all my kids would be there before we even asked them. A guest who would come with a meal that could change your life. Today in this passage of scripture that we're reading, surprise of surprise, Jesus is having breakfast with his disciples. He has appeared to them twice since the time of the resurrection as a group, and now it's the third time. And the third time, they have breakfast together. And none of them are late. They all come right to the table when it's ready. And so that's what we want to think about this morning, and under the umbrella of Revelation. Now, if you open your Bibles with me, if you use the ones provided near your seats, we're going to be reading from John 21, found on page 991. And I'd like you to look at verse 1 with me this morning and then look at a more literal word-for-word translation of that verse. The NIV has what's called the dynamic equivalent translation, so they smooth over a few things so that it flows more naturally, makes more sense to our English-speaking ears. And in the Bible you have in front of you, page 991, John 21 begins this way in verse 1. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Now take a look at the next slide, and you see a more literal word-for-word translation, and it catches what gets missed in the dynamic equivalent of the NIV. It says, after these things, Jesus revealed himself, that's the word that's translated appeared, again to his disciples at the Sea of Tiberias. That's also not a big deal. Tiberias was a city on the Sea of Galilee built by the Romans, and so when the Romans were in charge, people referred to it as the Sea of Tiberias. Most people referred to it as the Sea of Galilee. By the time John was writing, then they were talking about the Sea of Galilee, because the whole region's called Galilee. But here's what gets missed. It says, and he revealed himself this way. John, the gospel writer, makes a point to repeat the same word, which we lose in our other translation. And the word is either translated appeared or revealed. And I think we'll discover this morning from John 21 that this is about revelation. So allow revelation to be the word that lingers in your mind as we hear these words today. And we can go ahead to the next slide. I think that just has a repeat of what we're talking about. So revelation. This is a revelation of Jesus. There was the crucifixion, the burial, the resurrection. Jesus appears to his disciples, and then he appears to them again, and now this is the third time they see him. John chapter 21, this is God's holy word. Afterward, Jesus appeared to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, or the twin, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, which were James and John, and two other disciples were together. I'm going out to fish, Simon Peter told them. And they said, "We'll go with you." So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." Simon Peter climbed aboard and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. I'd like you to take a look at a picture taken on the shores of the Sea of Galilee. My daughter and I had the privilege of going to Israel, and we went to the place where tradition believes, church believes, somewhere along the shore, right here, is where Jesus had breakfast with his disciples. You can never say this is the exact spot, but somewhere along the shore. And this picture is taken, you know, from the perspective of you're sitting on the shore, like Jesus sat with his disciples and invited them for breakfast. He would have looked out on the Sea of Galilee as the sun was coming up, and he'd see their boat, and that's when he would call to them. And so just a picture to give you the biblical setting from that area, the Sea of Galilee, Sea of Tiberias, it's the same place. I'd like to think with you about a couple of things that are in the text this morning before we get to our main idea. John, the gospel writer, usually doesn't do anything by accident in his gospel. In fact, every word seems to matter. And take a look again at John chapter 21, verse 3. The disciples are out fishing, and it says, "So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing." Now, if you read John's gospel, you might remember another time when Jesus was talking to his disciples, and he uses that word, nothing. He was probably walking with them through a vineyard when he said to them, "I'm the vine, you're the branches. Apart from me, you can do nothing." He said, "But abide in me, and you will go and you'll bear fruit." Does John intend for us to see a connection there? They're out fishing, and they're fishermen, and it's been the whole night. Night was the normal time for fishing, and they've caught nothing. And now Jesus shows up, and they catch something. They catch a record catch of fish. And so Jesus says, they were out, and they caught nothing. That's how John tells us about what happened. We're not sure, but it does make you wonder as you read the Gospel of John. But here's something we're more sure about. John chapter 21, in verse 7 two times and in verse 12 one times, is a phrase that gets repeated. And whenever the authors of Scripture repeat something, it's like taking a yellow highlighter, you know, and putting it underneath it. That's the way they'd highlight, draw your attention to it. And this is the phrase. And if you're looking at the Scripture on the back of your bulletin, you might want to underline, you know, the three places where this gets repeated. "It's the Lord," John says. And then Peter says, give me my coat, I'm jumping in the water, it's the Lord. And then later they say, nobody wanted to ask him who he was because they knew it was the Lord. It's not by accident that it says, it's the Lord, it's the Lord, it's the Lord. God reveals and we recognize and respond. That's usually how life works. Sometimes we get it mixed up and we think, oh, I'm in a search for God and I'm going to go find him out there somewhere, figure him out. He's revealing all the time. He's always talking, always communicating, always revealing. And then we take great joy when he enables us to recognize, when we respond to what he delivers. He's revealing. And so their understanding of Jesus coming to them is, it's the Lord. They recognize what God is actually revealing. And so a couple, just those two notes to point out at this point in time. But the main idea, here's what I believe God is saying, the main idea from this text for us today is that the risen Jesus finds us, befriends us, and feeds our souls with the life of God. He finds us, befriends us, and feeds us. That's the good news, I think, for Jesus' disciples then and for us now, that God is always about the business of finding us. You can go all the way back to the beginning of the Bible and you discover Adam and Eve in the garden. And what happens? God says, don't do this, and they do it. And what do after they do it? They hide. And here comes God. Adam, Eve, where are you? They say, well, we're over here. What are you doing? We're hiding. Why? Well, because we ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil that you told us not to, and you might know how that story goes. But God finds them while they're hiding. That's the God we're talking about. Moses was one of the greatest leaders in the history of the world, especially in terms of leading people out of an occupied land into freedom. He's set to probably be Pharaoh or, you know, second to the throne in Egypt. Instead, he ends up being a herdsman. And he's out in the fields, and he's taking care of herds, and he's finding water for them, and he's finding food for them to eat, make sure there's something they could chew on for a while. And suddenly he sees a burning bush, and it doesn't burn up. And he goes to find out what in the world's going on, and suddenly he's on holy ground. God found him in the wilderness. David, the greatest king that God's people knew in ancient times, was out taking care of the sheep. And when Samuel came to anoint the next king, he starts going to the oldest brother and the next one and the next one, and every time he's like, this is not the one God wants. They said, are there any more sons? I'm supposed to anoint, you know, one of these sons. Well, yeah, there's David. He's out in the field taking care of the sheep. We'll bring him in. He says, that's the one. God found him. And now here, the disciples, and I think this is the best news of all for us today, what are they doing when Jesus finds them? Are they at church? Nope. Are they in a prayer meeting? Nope. They're at work. God finds them at work. I mean, previously they had gathered together and they were praying, and Jesus shows up and he says, my peace be with you. While they were there, they realized, hey, Thomas isn't here. So when Thomas came, they're like, Jesus is dead. He's alive. And Thomas says, no. Come on, you guys have lost it. You know, there's no way he could be alive. I don't know why you have this fantastical thinking, but until I put my finger in his hand and my hand in his side, you guys can believe what you want, but I know what I've seen. I watched. And then Jesus, when they're praying, appears again, and there's Thomas. And what does he say to Thomas? He doesn't say, Thomas, you know, what in the world? Why did you doubt? He says, Thomas, come here. And that's when Thomas puts his finger in his hand and puts his hand in his side, and he says, I believe. Those were kind of churchy settings, prayer meeting settings. Here, Jesus, in one of the three times that he appears to his disciples, appears to them at work, because some of them were fishermen. And so I wonder with you, are there more times in your life when you've been at work that you have said, wow, this is a God moment. This is a God-orchestrated conversation. This is a blessing from God, or a provision from God, or a word from God, or a comfort from God. Because you're only in church and prayer meetings, you know, one day of the week, maybe two. But all week long, you're at work. You know, you're working 6 days and resting a day. God is looking, finding people all week long. And so when you go back to your classroom, you go back to the marketplace, you go back to your office, you go back to the job site, God is in the business of finding you there. Of course, he can find you here. You're gathered with his people. You're slowing yourself down. You're pausing before his word. You're opening your heart. I mean, this is a perfect place for God to find you. But so is tomorrow and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday. God finds us. Jesus, the risen Jesus, finds us, and he often does it at work. He also befriends us, which is good news. With his disciples that he had lived with, he calls out to them with the kind of greeting that you and I would have with anybody else. You know, we would say, hey, how's it going? Jesus' term is probably not the best way to talk to a fisherman, because he says to the fisherman, you haven't any fish? You know, I think it's better to come up to a fisherman and say, are they biting? But he says, you don't have any fish? They're like, no. Well, cast your net on the other side. I got an idea for you. Now, the fact that the disciples did that is a small miracle in and of itself. Imagine you've been fishing all night. Some guy, who they don't know who it is, yells to you from the shore and says, why don't you try the other side? Well, their nets were so big, either dragging, you know, behind a boat, or a huge net that you'd throw out into the water. It would take multiple people to launch this baby out there. To gather that all in and get it off to the other side, that took some effort. But like with everything else, when God gives you a command, he enables you to do it. Here, their answer should have been, you don't know what you're talking about. But instead, they put the net on the other side, and sure enough, it's full of fish, and they're like, we've never felt the net like this before, and it's so full of fish they can't even get it in. Their friend, Jesus, hey, how's it going? I got an idea for you. Later he says, why don't you bring some of those fish? You know, it makes sense if you're God that you would just provide everything. But instead he says to the disciples, how about I use what you have, what you caught? He doesn't even say to them, why don't you bring some of those fish that I miraculously provided for you? He says, bring some of the fish that you caught. And he gives them the opportunity. He's no longer calling them servants, as he said before. He calls them friends. Jesus explained to his disciples before, a servant is someone who doesn't know his master's business. But my Father sent me, and I'm telling you what his business is. I'm going to call you friend. That's a big change for the disciples. Might be a big change for you. When Jesus says that when you pray, say Father in this close relationship, that God's not far away and above, but he wants you to know him as Father. And Jesus says, I want you to know me as friend. He keeps breaking down whatever barriers we might have erected that keep us separated. And so he befriends us like he befriended his disciples. And finally, he feeds us, body and soul. His disciples receive some food. You're out all night fishing, you're hungry, they get some food. So their bodies were satisfied with fish and with bread. But when you read the Gospel of John, you quickly notice that every time Jesus breaks bread, something miraculous is happening. He doesn't include the account of the Last Supper, but if you read the other Gospel writers, you realize that it was when he was breaking bread with his disciples at the Last Supper that he was giving them a picture of what was to come. Today, we're going to break bread as part of our worship, remembering Jesus' body broken and then his blood shed. But when Jesus was on the road to Emmaus with two people who had been in Jerusalem during the time of the crucifixion, now he's risen from the dead, he's walking along with them, and they're saying, "Hey, have you heard about what happened?" He's like, "Well, no, tell me." And so they tell him everything that happened. It's all about him, of course. And he finally gets to their house, and they sit down, and it says when he broke the bread with them, their eyes were opened, and he explained the scriptures that pointed to the coming of the Messiah. And so when John says here, Jesus makes breakfast for the disciples, and they have fish and bread, we need to pay attention to that bread. Because most likely, he's not just giving them something for their hungry stomachs. He's giving them himself for their souls and their spirits as well. It's bread. Bread and fish is what they get. If you look through the history of Christian art, you discover that when the Last Supper with Jesus and his disciples is portrayed, there's a whole school of art that instead of having like what we have in front of us today, bread and a cup, the pictures that the artists paint have bread and fish because they're affected by this story. Jesus appearing to his disciples as the resurrected Lord, and what do they have? Bread and fish. Bread and fish. The risen Jesus finds us, befriends us, and feeds our souls with the life of God. Main idea that God wants us to notice this morning. But you can't probably read this passage without some questions coming up. For me, here's the two that came to my mind. The number 153. Well, if you read the Bible and you pay attention to details, you say, why is that in there? 153? Does that have some special meaning? Well, if you're interested in the most humorous answer, which comes from one of the smartest human beings ever, see me later, because St. Augustine, who has blessed the world with his mind and writing, has one of the craziest interpretations, I think, of the 153. Does funny things with numbers, but takes too long to explain, and there's no blessing in it. But over coffee, it's fun to talk about. Most commentators who see some kind of helpful meaning in that say it's either this or this. It's either there were 153 known species of fish in that time, and Jesus is using the 153 as a visible metaphor for all people, because at one point in time, you might remember, Jesus told his disciples, "I know you're fishermen, but in addition to catching fish, I'm also gonna have you catch people." And so the 153 might be representative of all kinds of fish that exist and all kinds of people that exist. I don't know, that might be it. Or if you're a fisherman, how many fishermen here? Fisherwomen, fisher people? A few of you? Have you ever gone fishing and caught some large fish and brought them home and not known how many you caught? Like, we just caught a bunch of fish. My guess is you probably knew we caught 22 and two got away, or three we threw back. You know exactly. And if it was a record, I mean, if you took your fish and you squished them down to measure them, to make them as big as possible, you know, it was record, you'd know exactly how many inches or millimeters that fish was. So it's also possible that the 153 is just, this was a record, and somebody counted, and we want to take note of it. And the nets didn't break. If you know your Bible stories, you know there was a time when they caught a bunch of fish, a miraculous catch, and the nets broke. Here, the nets didn't break. So this was so big. How big was it? It was 153. So it might just be a fisherman's way of telling a story to give us the account. So it might have no meaning at all. And then again, it might. Nobody really knows for sure. But here's another question that I think is good news for us. A question about the text, actually in the text. It says, none of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. The disciples wanted to ask a question, but they didn't. Here, John lets us get inside of the heads of the disciples, and they must have talked about it later and said, I really wanted to say, you know, is it you, Jesus? But I didn't, because I knew it was him. And the good news is, for his disciples then, and I think for you and for me today, is that it is possible. In fact, it is likely that you will live with a sense and a question and a doubt at the same time that you live with deep belief. It's not often you are just totally one or the other. You see it in the Psalms all the time. You read the Psalms of Lament, and the psalmist says, God, how long till you do something? God, are you listening? God, do you even exist anymore? And then by the time they get to the end of their psalm, their prayer, their song, they're saying, I put my trust in you. This combination of a question or a doubt or a wondering and a deep and strong belief. They wanted to ask him who he was, but they didn't. In their mind, they just had this sense of, is it Jesus? But it is Jesus. It is Jesus. And God can use that to make you grow. That combination, that wondering, that I believe, but I also have this question. God says, perfect. Perfect, because you'll probably have a new question tomorrow and next week and next year or at this stage of life. You'll have a new question. So it's okay to believe and to doubt and to do it simultaneously. None of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? They knew it was the Lord. Why does John put that in there? I think he wants to let us know the state of the disciples and the state of growing in your relationship with Jesus, that you'll probably have both those things all the time. Well, what do we do with this? How do we put it into action? Here's a few application suggestions. If you're like Peter, the application would be drop everything and dive in. Miraculous catch of fish. We're hanging on to the net. We're hoping it's not going to break. We're trying to get this boat into shore. And suddenly John says to Peter, it's the Lord. And Peter drops the net, grabs his coat, and dives in the water. And he's on his way. When's the last time you ran 100 meters? Or, more difficult, when's the last time you swam 100 meters? Peter grabs his coat, which you say, why'd he do that? Well, they're out fishing. You know, he's probably down to you know, just a pair of shorts. He puts his coat on. We would say, if you're going to jump in the water, take your coat off. But if you were going to go meet a rabbi or a teacher, and now he says, it's the Lord, you're going to go meet the Messiah, you would dress appropriately, even if it meant swimming 100 yards with your coat on. And so he does what you do. You would never go walk up to Jesus, you know, just bare-chested if you had a coat to put on. So he puts his coat on, swims. I just read this week that an NFL player broke the record for the 40-yard dash at the combine, ran a 4.22. I wonder if Peter set the record that day for the 100-meter swim on the Sea of Galilee, you know, for the whole region with your coat on. He goes. He drops everything, and he goes. And sometimes that's what God wants us to, the way that God wants us to respond. You've questioned, you've wondered, you've investigated, you've had something before you, and it's time to drop everything and cross the line of faith. It's time to drop everything and move ahead. I can remember when I was in college, I was a freshman in college, and I was reading the Bible for the first time. I had grown up in a Christian home, and I had read pieces of the Bible, but I never really read the whole Bible. But God was grabbing a hold of me and making me interested in his word. And the more I was in it, the more I was interested. And my brother was raising all kinds of questions for me. And, you know, he was saying things like, well, if you were raised in a Muslim home, wouldn't you be Muslim instead of Christian? I'm 18 years old, and I'm like, I don't know, you know, probably, I think, yes, no, I don't know, and all kinds of questions. So set me off on a course of investigating. Do I really believe what my parents believed? Is this true? Is Christianity, you know, reliable? All those kinds of questions. And God kept providing all kinds of answers. Answers, answers, answers. Every question, an answer. And so I thought, I believe, but I'm not sure. And God just kept providing, kept providing. Finally, one night, a friend of mine is in a serious accident, and I find out about it on the other side of campus, and that sort of shocked me. And I'm walking back to my dorm, and so I'm in a, you know, a state of like prayer and talking to God about my friend, and walking back, I'm walking down the sidewalk, and I can still see like the sidewalk, the lamp, Trinity Christian College campus. And as if God said, do you need more information? You know, all your questions, all your wonderings, even your doubts. Is there anything else I have to provide for you? And I don't know why he chose that moment, except he had my attention. And I thought, no. What am I waiting for? It's time to drop everything and jump in. And so from a child's faith to a faith of my own, God made it a moment to just drop everything and jump in. I've been in ever since. He started a process of changing a math and computer science guy into a pastor. I mean, how unlikely is that? But sometimes that's what has to happen. For other people, there's a slow path of change and transformation, like an artist shaping a pot, you know, a potter making something out of clay. So God works like that. Sometimes he's looking for a Peter response. Let's go now. Interesting thing in the Gospel of John, Dale Bruner, my favorite Bible commentator, draws this out in his commentary on the Gospel of John. He says, I think that there's a little competition going on between John and Peter. You know, Jesus' three closest disciples, Peter, James, and John. He says, this is why. He says, John, who always refers to himself as the beloved disciple, I mean, that's one way of doing it, right? We're not sure what he doesn't want to mention his own name, but he still calls himself the beloved disciple. So say, what's up with that, John? Not sure, are you saying anyone else is less loved? So you're not sure. But he includes little details like this. When they found out that the tomb was empty, who ran to the tomb? John and Peter. John tells us who got there first. John did. And he stood by the entrance of the tomb. He was faster and respectful. Peter gets there second, and he charges into the tomb. John tells us all about that. Now, they're on the boat, and nobody knows who Jesus is on the shore. Who happens to recognize who Jesus is? John recognizes him first. And then Peter, second, responds. You know, Peter's no slouch, and he jumps in the water, and he takes off. And so there's this little interplay between John and Peter, it seems like. John, who's writing the story, includes it in there. But he recognizes in his friend Peter, oh, this inner attitude of an early adopter who says, when I believe something, I don't need to know anymore, I'm ready to act. And that was Peter. Or he's ready to speak. And so sometimes you come to the point in your life where you've been on the fence for so long, God says, would you just drop everything and dive in? What more do you want me to do for you? How much more do I have to convince you? What else do I need to do to persuade you? Just drop everything and dive in. The other thing we learn from Jesus here, and it's the exact opposite of what we teach our kids, is that when it comes to Jesus, it's better to receive. When it comes to human relationships, it's better to give. It's much better for me to give my life away for your sake, because when I do, God just pours more of his life into me. That's how his economy works. It's always better to give. You're doing exactly what God does, and then he's the one who fills you up. But when it comes to Jesus, it's better to open your hands and receive. Jesus says, you guys want to have some breakfast? They're like, sure, I guess so. I mean, do you wonder what it was like for Peter? I mean, he got there first. Swimming. But, you know, you swim for a while, finally you can stand up, right? And did he run up to Jesus? It doesn't tell us anything about, like, he embraced him or fell down. But I would imagine he was swimming for all he was worth. And then he can walk. And then, you know, you can trudge through the water. And now you can go as fast as you want through the water, but you're dripping wet. You got a coat on. You're soaked. And you get up to Jesus. And there you stand. The same Jesus that he denied 3 times. The first time they met, Jesus never said anything to him about the denial. The second time they met, this is after the resurrection, he confirms Thomas in his doubting. Doesn't say anything to Peter. But this breakfast is the prelude, if you read the rest of the chapter, to Jesus talking directly to Peter about his denial and his reinstatement. And it starts with being able to open your hands and receive. How about some fish? How about the bread? It's better when you're with Jesus to receive. And finally, this happened in chapter 20, and now at the end of chapter 21, but in the middle here, the message is still the same. Go and tell. Go and tell. Jesus is alive. That's the message. He was dead, and now he's alive. He was buried and crucified, and now he's risen. He's alive. That's the message that you have as a church. That's the message that you have as a follower. Death has been defeated. The evil one, you are now set free from him. Jesus is alive. Just go and tell. Because Jesus said, friends, I know you're used to catching fish. Keep on fishing. Nothing against fishing. But from now on, you will catch people. You will catch people with the good news that the tomb is empty and Jesus is alive. Let's pray together. Jesus, we thank you today that long ago you did not stop searching and finding people that you love. And we thank you that in this place, we know you commonly search for and find people. You find our attentive ears. You find an open heart. You find our souls and spirits waiting to hear good news from you. And all week long, wherever we are, in a classroom or marketplace or job site, you promise to be searching and finding us. And so we pray, open our eyes to recognize you. Open our minds to understand you. Open our spirits to receive you. We thank you for your friendship. We thank you for your provision for our bodies. We thank you for the way that simple bread and juice can nourish our souls. Lord, we pray that your good news will be on our lips. It'll be shown in our actions. It'll be found in our compassion. That we will have your good news to share with all the world. We pray this all in your great name. Amen. Please rise in body or spirit as we join together in song.
The sound of your great name.
Today, Jesus says, come and have a meal with me. We break bread and we share a cup today, remembering the Lord Jesus. The Lord Jesus, who on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, this is my body. Whenever you eat it, do this in remembrance of me. He gave thanks and he broke it. His thanks was a prayer. And today I invite you to join in prayer with the words that Jesus taught us to pray, the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. In a similar way, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And when he poured out the cup, he said, this is the cup of the new covenant, which is in my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. Today you're invited to eat and to drink the cup. To eat and drink the bread and the cup. To take the bread and eat it and to remember that Jesus' body was broken for the complete forgiveness of all of our sins. And to take the cup and drink it and to remember that the blood of Jesus was shed for the complete forgiveness and cleansing of all of our sins. This is God's gift to us. He's finding you. He's finding me. He calls us friends. He says, call me Father. These are the gifts of God prepared for the people of God. Today, you'll have a chance to receive them at three different stations, and I invite the elders who are going to serve you to come forward at this time. There'll be a station on my right, and there'll be one on my left, and there'll be one in the back. We're going to invite you when the music starts, and we're going to sing together for part of the time. But as soon as the music starts, if you're in the front, if you'd lead the way, you can come out the center aisle, receive the elements at one of these two stations, and then go back to your seats. In the back, you can do the same. You can go out the center aisle, receive the elements, and return to your seats down the aisles. And if you're in the middle, you kind of have your choice, if you want to go to the back or the front. In the balcony, the back would be much closer for you, of course, and return to your seats. Take the elements, return to your seat, consume them when you're ready. You might want to spend some time praying. You might be ready to dive right in. Thank you, God, and immediately take those elements. But let this be your time to receive from Jesus. When it comes to Jesus making a meal for you, it is better to receive. Elders, please come and receive the elements. Our worship team will lead us, and as the music begins, please come to the front or to the back. Thank you. With the psalmist, we say, bless the Lord, O my soul, all that is within me, bless his holy name. Please join me in prayer. God our Father, Jesus the Son, and Holy Spirit, how grateful we are that you found us, you fed us, and you've befriended us. You've called us your own. Nourish us, we pray, body and soul this day, with your holy presence and your power. Fill us with your peace, O God, the peace that passes understanding. And may we go from this place with good news on our lips, good news in our hearts, good news that makes our hands and feet move for your glory, O God, and for the blessing of the nations. Thank you for meeting us at your table. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, the deacons will receive your gifts, your tithes, and your offerings that you have prepared. There are two offerings this morning, one for the general fund and one for our building fund. And while those gifts are being received, we have a couple of announcements to share with you. Are you guys staying up here during this time? Okay. I see him up here, I'm thinking, what am I forgetting? You know, but I'm not forgetting anything. That's good. So deacons, please come forward, who are going to be receiving gifts. As they do, just a couple of updates to the list of prayer requests in your bulletin or reminders. One is that Virginia Kuiper will have surgery this week. Please keep Virginia in your prayers. And also Evelyn Vanderkoy, who was in the hospital due to complications with the flu, has returned to Sunset, and she is back there now, but still in a very weakened state. So please remember Evelyn in your prayers. This morning, we want to welcome new members to Emmanuel, Dick and Margaret Patmus. I think we have a picture to show to you of them, and they are also here in real life. So would you guys just stand for a moment? Would you give them a warm welcome? How about that, Dick? You're welcome as a new member, and they hand you an offering plate. Go figure. As I've gotten to know Dick and Margaret, we welcome them not only as new members at Emmanuel, but as grandparents joining their kids and grandkids. Their daughter Anna is seated right in front of them, married to Jeremy, with their grandkids in the aisle as well. So we welcome you to Emmanuel as members, as grandparents and parents as well. We've been praying for one of your grandchildren quite a bit, and we continue to pray that that treatment restores his life and that those complications will be less and less. I'm sure you could talk to Dick about things like chicken or eggs, but I think he'd rather talk to you about time in the Air Force, which we've had some wonderful conversations about already. Was it the Air Force? I know it was with planes. It was the Air Force. And you might want to ask Margaret about a children's Bible book that she shared with me that God used to just plant the seed of the gospel deep into her heart years and years ago. And so those stories that you learn as a child, God continues to water those, and they bear fruit for a lifetime. And we just want to welcome you to Emmanuel. God bless you as we grow together, share life together, and continue to grow in love together. Welcome to Emmanuel Church. We also have an update this morning. It's not from Kids Hope, because Eva Marie made the arrangements. Someone was assuming it was Kids Hope because she's our Kids Hope director, but she also wears a GEMS Girls Club leader hat. Oh, they need to borrow your worship team microphones, and they're going to tell you an update on the fundraising dinner which recently took place and how God provided more than our GEMS girls and counselors asked or imagined. So you girls want to step right up to the line here. They'll be able to see you nicely.
We had our GEMS supper on February 15 to raise money for the Esther School in Zambia. You might be wondering, why did the GEMS choose to raise a school up there?
Well, here are a couple facts about Zambia. Over half the population lives below the poverty line. In the Zambian schools, the class sizes can have over 60 kids in them with one teacher, and the school day only lasts 2 to 4 hours.
So, the Esther School saw that need. They are working to help the Zambian students beat the odds. Each classroom at the Esther School has only 24 kids in a class, and is equally divided between 12 boys and 12 girls. All of the students at the Esther School are either orphans or underprivileged. The Esther School is also working to teach kids life skills, such as sewing, cooking, and woodworking.
We want to give you all a giant thank you for supporting the GEMS Esther School. As a church, you are amazing. Through your generous donations, we were able to raise, are you ready?
$6,000.
You went above and beyond. Our goal this year was $3,000, and you gave enough for twice that amount. We are now able to give $3,600 to Raise Them Up campaign. This campaign helps to furnish the newly built classrooms for grades 4 to 6. You can see some of the Esther School classrooms in the pictures on the screen.
With the other $2,400, we can also now sponsor 2 students for the next school year. The student sponsorship program allows kids to have access to a Christian education, English language resources, nutritious meals, healthy screenings, uniforms, and school supplies. We look forward to getting pictures from our sponsored kids and sending them letters throughout the year.
Thank you for a fun evening, great food, lots of fun conversation, and all the donations. You are amazing, Emmanuel family.
Let's stand and conclude our worship with Jesus Firm Foundation.
Mm-hmm.
Go with God's blessing. May the Lord your God bless you and keep you in his care. May he cause his face to shine brightly upon you, and may the Lord your God turn toward you and be gracious to you. May his Holy Spirit fill you with his power, with his presence, and his peace. And all God's people say, amen. Go in peace.